Hello and welcome back to the Join Dota League Season 3 here on HeflaTV 2. I didn't want to play the full intro again as that would be a long time before we actually get back into the Dota, but we are going to have Game 2 shortly. As Immunity as well as the entirety of Zero Latitude are back in the lobby, and this is going to be a Captain's Mode game unlike the first iteration of the second game of the series. So thank you for sticking with me through the awkward time of me trying to fill the air, and then eventually turning on the music as we're waiting for, let's see, who was it? Can't remember. Possibly was Spice. I can't even. But either way, into the draft we'll go as, well, to start us off, I guess I'll introduce myself. I'm Grandis V, yet again casting for the Join Dota League Season 3 here on HeflaTV 2. And, well, as we're still waiting for the first couple bans to come out from both of these teams, I guess I'll take this time to go ahead and tell a lame joke that I pulled from the Twitch chat several days ago. So, here it goes. Why does Luna hate Venomancer? And the reason is, because Venomancer is always trying to poison Nova. It's so hard to tell jokes without Cocaster, and my delivery is so awful, but you know, whatever. We'll just try to clear the air with that one. Yeah, we'll leave that at that. No more jokes for me. But yeah. We're back into the game, and sorry about that last song. Yeah, I know it's a little departure from the norm. I just pressed it on shuffle and tried to get whatever I could up fast enough, so yeah, as lame as that is. Well, getting into this game, with Doom being banned out first by Zero Latitude, Lycanthrope, Brewmaster, taken out by Immunity, Dota. Usually when we have a draft, it's a little bit easier to talk about it since it's a little further on, but as it stands, these are pretty standard meta bans. It is going to be first pick for Immunity Dota, and they won't be able to pick up the Razor as Zero Latitude take that one away from them, but Faceless Void, as well as pretty much every support imaginable, is available in the pool. Unless you're thinking about playing a support Brewmaster or a 4 Doom, that's about it. And Immunity Dota, they're going to get their hands on the Tinker this time as he is available in the pool. A very annoying hero to be playing up against, especially on the Radiant side. Tinker can be absolutely devastating. And if last game was any indication, their ability to get farm around the map as well as to get kills is very strong, and if we have anything that can combo with that, maybe a Beastmaster, crossing my fingers for that one, or maybe even something a little bit more conventional, like a Nature's Prophet, just anything that's going to offer summons that are roaming around the map for the Tinker to teleport to, this could be a very scary pick coming out from Immunity Dota. 5 seconds. I'm going to sit a little bit in chat as we are just waiting on everything to come out. Zero Latitude probably going to pick up the Faceless Void after the Death Prophet, as their first two picks would be a really solid opener, or they could get their hands on the Shadow Shaman here. There's a lot of different ways they could angle this draft, so any one of them could be solid. Death Prophet is really good as far as pushing is concerned up against a Tinker because her push is not counteracted by the March of Machines, although she will take a lot of damage from it. She will be able to tank through it pretty easily, especially if there's a natural pipe carrier on the other part of her team, and the Exorcism Spirits aren't bothered by it at all. Tidehunter is actually going to be next picker for Zero Latitude, not the hero that I was expecting, but still going to be a solid offlaner to offer them more teamfight potential, and we saw last game how devastating Ravage on 3 or 4 heroes can be in those teamfights, and I'm looking forward to seeing them play it. Immunity Dota get their hands onto the Skywrath Mage. No big surprises there, as he'll be the pickup. Yeah, Skywrath Mage is a really solid support hero. What else can I say? Shadow Shaman the Band coming up from Immunity Dota. I'd expect the Faceless Void to also be taken out of this pool, and yeah, no big surprises there, as we'll finally get to see the wonderful chat's reaction to my terrible pun. But yeah, into the game we go. Shadow Shaman as well as Bristleback banned out from either team, and it's not as if we expected anything different. Centaur as well as Nature's Prophet are pretty much your premier offlaners available still in the draft, that either team could snag up for themselves, but more than likely Zero Latitude already have their offlaner in the form of that Tidehunter, so we're probably going to see the Centaur banned out from Zero Latitude. I think that would be a solid ban coming out from them, as that's probably one of the best initiators left in the pool, especially with Nature's Prophet also taking out, which is actually an interesting ban coming out from Immunity Dota. That'll be an option. If they went for the Nature's Prophet, I'd expect a support Tidehunter to be going to lane for Zero Latitude. Yeah, I'm kind of torn about support Tide Hunter, but if he gets his level 6 up at a decent time, it's the same old Tide. He's still able to pick up his Ravage and then roam around and get some early kills with that. So yeah, Centaur Warrunner is going to be the ban coming up from Zero Latitude. No big surprises there, as the offlaner pool for Immunity Dota is going to be fairly sparse here. And I'm not sure what they're going to pick. There's very few that actually
10 seconds to go
are picked up in the current meta right now. Timbersaw might be solid if Zero Latitude commit higher into the strength tanky frontliners. But other than that, I'm not exactly sure what they're going to pick up. Actually, Faceless Void. I take that back. That's exactly what they're going to pick if Zero Latitude doesn't take it. That'll be their offlane hero. I was expecting him to be banned, but it's not going to be so. And Zero Latitude pick up the Viper. I think this is pretty much a no-brainer Faceless Void pick. With the Tinker and Scarth Mage already, they have plenty of damage to pump into that Chronosphere. And if you catch it on more than two heroes, or two or more, rather, that's pretty much a one-team fight. Because you can focus one of them with the Void, drop a Mystic Flare onto the other one, and then you're starting out 5v3, which is ridiculous if you can get that Faceless Void as early farm. And although as an offlane Faceless Void, he won't be able to get that with the damage that comes out from the Sky and the Tinker, I think that can be warranted. So I don't think that this pick is going to be much of a difficulty for them to snag. Death Prophet is problematic inside the Chronosphere because her exorcism is not stopped and the spirits can still go to work inside the Chrono. But even then, she's really easy to focus down if you catch her out in the Chronosphere. So unless she's absolutely stacked and gets off to a ridiculous start, I'm liking Immunity Dota's lineup a lot if they pick up the Faceless Void. The Viper pick for Zero Latitude is... Oh. Huh.
Dire's pick.
I don't like this pick at all. Weaver is already facing up against Ravage and a Silence from the Death Prophet, and Zero Latitude have plenty of other tools that they could pick up in order to lock him down. In particular, their supports, probably like an Earthshaker would be really solid at offering the lockdown. But Weaver, I can see the mentality behind it. He's going to be able to negate pretty much all of the slows coming out from the Viper, as well as you'll have to commit Ravage if you want to kill him. So if he gets up a BKB, this Weaver is going to be pretty much unkillable. So in that sense, this pick could definitely work out for Immunity Dota. This is definitely not a game for your Lincoln Sphere, especially now with a Rubick on the pitch. He'll be able to break it with the Fade Bolt and then lift you up, and then he'll be able to follow up with Ravage as well as Silence. But yeah, I don't know, this Weaver pick, I would have liked the Faceless Void a lot better. And they could have waited on the Weaver. Weaver is a hero, his biggest problem is whether or not he'll be able to get online fast enough. In this game, he definitely has the opportunity to, but I think if they waited on the pick, it would have been better for Immunity Dota.
10 seconds to go.
Yeah, I think that's a fair summation of how that's going to work out. If Immunity Dota get off to an early start, this Weaver could have a field day. And if he's stuck on building a BKB and goes into a Lincoln Sphere next, I'm hating it. I don't know. I'm generally not the biggest fan of a Weaver unless there's like nothing to lock him down, or very little, and he can actually afford to get a Desolator first, or maybe like a little bit of items to tank up, maybe like a casual Ogre Club into the BKB after. But yeah, it's going to be an Enigma coming out from Immunity Dota. They're picking this Enigma into a Rubick, which is kind of peculiar. They have some pretty decent ways to cancel the Black Hole. Silence as well as the Lift coming out from Rubick. But it's not the greatest. They have very little if the Rubick and Death Prophet are caught out inside the Chrono. And if Enigma catches those two, it's probably going to be a one-team fight. Tide Hunter can counter-initiate with the Ravage. But I can definitely see this Enigma working out for them. Although, it's a tad greedy and I'm not the biggest fan of it, it definitely can work. And as we saw last game, their team fights were really on point and caught out a lot of heroes. So if you're able to replicate what they did with the Ravage last game, now this time, with the Enigma Black Hole, it would be really solid. So it's still yet to be seen. It's kind of unfortunate that the remakes are happening, and it really is quite a bummer. But we will be able to get further on into the game as Clockwork's going to be the ban coming out from Zero Latitude. Assuming that Weaver's not going towards the offlane and instead is going to be the safe lane farmer, which I think is probably the better place to lane him, especially with a Scarth Mage and Enigma as supports, they're not going to be able to go aggressive very effectively and support the Weaver. Although I don't think he'd die in lane if they threw him to the fishes, so to say. And Immunity Dota could go for a very greedy core pick.
Reserve time.
Yeah, so we are going to have the Earthshaker ban coming out from Immunity to Dota. I think that's a solid ban. Definitely would have given them a lot more lockdown as well as a long-range way to cancel the fissure. The black hole. Your premier way to cancel the black hole is going to be your Vengeful Spirit, and that could still be a solid pick for Zero Latitude. On the Dire side, would give them a decent amount of minus armor with the Gush as well as the Howl of Terror, or Wave of Terror, in order to take down Roshan. Although they don't have the best summons, they will have the Exorcism as well. And could be a solid support, although playing from behind with a Vengeful Spirit is not what you want to be doing. I think it would be okay, as long as they're confident that their lanes are going to do well. And would also give them a pretty solid way to roam around and lock down this Weaver. I think it's pretty good. Zero Latitude have plenty of time to think about this last pick, so it's probably not going to come out for quite some time. As we're still waiting on the last pickup. Reserve time is being eaten through by Zero Latitude. I'm assuming that this is going to be a support, although they could have that Tidehunter be the support pair with the Rubick, which wouldn't be the worst, but they wouldn't be able to get as much out of the map, I feel, if they did do that, and they wouldn't have another support to lock down this Weaver. If they did go for it, I think you're probably going to want to commit into the push and maybe, let's see. Yeah, I'm really not sure. I think this is for sure another support. Other than Vent, you could go for a Wraith King, which would be pretty solid. Functions a little bit better from behind. We'll offer the Wraithfire Blast as well as a nice way to slow from an AoE with the Reincarnation slow whenever he comes back online. That would be pretty solid, and I definitely would like it. But instead, it's going to be a Lion. Now, Lion is a hero that's been more or less ignored throughout a lot of drafts, but I think he's a pretty solid support when you don't know exactly what you want to do and you want that extra lockdown. Up against a Weaver, Lion is amazing, because if you land the Finger of Death on him, he's not a particularly tanky hero, and Weaver will definitely be able to be taken down in his entirety, and yeah, I think it's pretty solid.
10 seconds to go. 5 seconds.
Yeah. Let's see, especially the other heroes like the Skyrath Mages and the Enigma can be burst down very easily by this Finger of Death, and whenever it's off cooldown, I'd like to see this Lion make a rotation around the map. He's not going to get the fastest Blink Dagger by any means, but if Zero Latitude win a couple of teamfights, it definitely is an option. And with a Viper, as well as a Tidehunter, Viper presumably getting an early mechanism, it's going to be fairly easy for them to do so. We're looking for this last core presumably coming out from Immunity. I'm going to guess that they're going to switch the Weaver towards the offlane because I'm not sure there's a better cure to put there, but actually, Faceless Void is still in the draft, and I still think it would be pretty solid. Faceless Void is going to offer them the Chronosphere to lock down heroes, then they can follow up with the Black Hole. You're going to have the double bubble, but no, it's going to be an Abaddon. Abaddon Weaver definitely could work out. That's going to bump the Skyrath Mage towards the mid and maybe a safe lane farming Tinker. I have no idea how these lanes are going to work out for Immunity, especially with Shaitan playing on it, who was their support last game. So we're in for a little bit of a treat here, as they're just going to want to make this Weaver go absolutely ham. Whenever he gets stunned up, they're going to want to try to purge that off with the Aphotic Shield coming up from the Abaddon. Yeah, I don't know how these lanes are going to work out for them. That really throws a wrench in the works, for me at least. It's going to make it very interesting to see how they actually settle down. I'm going to guess that Tinker is going to go solo safe, with Skyrath Mage towards the mid, Weaver and Abaddon in the aggressive offlane, and then we'll have Enigma
10 seconds
taking up the jungle. That's going to leave Tinker pretty susceptible to being ganked by this Rubick and Lion, but I think it's probably their best laning bet. As Tinker versus a Tidehunter, Tinker should be just fine, although Anchor Smash is annoying and will get some harass. It's not going to come out as consistently as if he were a melee hero, but enough of that, as we're going to see how these lanes are going to work as we jump into game number 2 of the best of 2 series between Zero Latitude and Immunity, as we are going to have the Enigma played by Godot going towards the top lane, so an offlane Enigma maybe, as Chains is going to be taking up the Tinker, and bottom lane is going to be a tri-lane with Ming playing on the Weaver, Intel, or rather, no, Shaitan playing on the Abaddon, and that will leave, last but not least, on the side of Radiant Risk playing on the Scarlet Mage, and the other team is going to be Zero Latitude, the team that is going to be facing up against Titan in just a couple of hours, as Koala is going to be leading the charge towards the bottom on the Lycan, Spica on the Viper, and Levita playing on the Rubick. Mid lane is going to be Death Prophet played by Accelerate, and solo safe lane, we're going to have Vans by the Tidehunter, who, up against the Enigma, it's not a matchup I've seen in ever. is solo Enigma versus Tidehunter. And yeah, that's probably because I haven't seen offlane Enigma more than 3 times in competitive Dota. Offlane Enigma definitely can be a thing, but I think his Eidolons are just going to die too quickly. The Anchor Smash coming out from the Tidehunter, and they can't put much pressure onto him, although he'll be able to get a decent amount of farm. So will the Tide, so this top lane should be more or less a wash, I'm going to say. Maybe a slight favor towards the Tidehunter if he feeds away too many Eidolons. Tinker, he's going to defend his Ancients. They're not going to be blocked up by Zero Latitude, which honestly I think is a bit of a mistake coming out from them. You really want to commit one of those wards. I don't think they've handed one towards the Death Prophet, and no, they haven't. So those Ancients are going to be available for chains, and he's liable to get a very early start, although his block is not going to be as good as the Death Prophet's if Accelerate does not mess it up, and she won't. All of her creeps will be behind her, and Tinker is going to be, as far as lane equilibrium, a little bit delayed, although with the double damage rune as well as the Ancients available, it's going to be pretty solid. Weaver down in bottom with these supports. This is a scary lane to go up against, although the Viper also has quite a decent amount of killing potential if they're able to lock down the Abaddon. I think it's really the only target you can go on, or if you isolate Risk, him too. Yeah, offlane Enigma, one of the things that I wasn't considering was the fact that he's able to deny off one of his own creeps, much like a Lich that you're going to see in the offlane, and that's actually going to tip the lane in his favor, especially if he keeps on controlling the lane like he is. Enigma should be doing just fine, actually, and this laning situation might work out very well for immunity, as that Abaddon pick just kind of came out of nowhere and caught me, and probably caught Zero Latitude off guard. Lion, currently not able to do anything, only level 1. Might go for Hex, might go for Earth Spike. We still have yet to see that. And Levita, as well as Koala, have done nothing here. They don't have a CS, they don't have a Deny, and they're going to contest the pole coming out from the Radiant. And this is something that you definitely can do with their heroes. And now, Chitan might get caught out here if they lock him down. He could be in a lot of trouble. He's looking for the last hit, and they're going to start zoning with the Scarlet Mage as well. Abaddon, I don't think he should be able to get this. They're going to start with the Earth Spike, and now the Poison Attacks are going to come out with the Abaddon Shield. He's going to be able to make a turn, however, and they won't go for him. Yeah. Pole going to be protected coming out from the Radiant team, and they'll get all of the big creeps last hits with the exception of the one Ogre. That's probably not going to die at all. Lion, potentially looking to throw out a spell, but going to be stopped. Yeah, we're just waiting. They will throw an Earth Spike. Last hit is going to go the way of Zero Latitude. So a slight win for them as far as these supports are concerned, but the Weaver is doing very well in lane up against the Vipers. 6-0 versus the 3-3. So not dominating by any stretch of the imagination, but doing well. Getting a little bit more farm than the Viper. And now back to this lane we go. I'm not a huge fan of the way these supports are positioning themselves. They could be playing a little bit more aggressively with the boots first on the Lion, but they're just not able to do so. They're going to sit on the rune. It is a haste, and even if the Lion shows his face, Chitan will be able to pick that one up, and it might be secured by the Death Prophet. Let's see. No, Abaddon just going to pick that one up, feeling it's a little too risky, and well, from the high ground, they're going to auto-attack onto Koala with that Arcane Bolt. Now the bugs are coming out onto Levita. They're diving onto Koala. They've rotated in the Death Prophet, but I think Koala's going to give up the first blood. He isn't going to be tagged by the Gemini attack. He actually missed uphill, and now Ming is in a lot of trouble. Abaddon gets the first blood, but Weaver is going to give up his death because the Fade Time was just not there coming out from the excuse me, Shikuchi, but on top, we have the Enigma killing off the Tidehunter, not something I was anticipating. Win for immunity? Question mark. Despite losing their safe lane hero, they did get the first blood as well as a solo kill onto their offlane Enigma, which is wonderful for them. Although Weaver is traditionally thought of as a really hard carrying hero, getting the farm on him isn't, I don't know, it's, he can play from behind decently well, by at least not dying and being able to farm, I should say. He's not going to have the game impact that he wants, but he'll at least not die. There's a silver lining, and I don't think that's going to happen again. He just played a little too aggressively, and that uphill miss really messed him up. Tinker going to have his boots as well as bottle and soaring. Oh, actually, where's his bottle? That's very peculiar to see a Tinker without a bottle at 3 minutes in. Also a very fast soul ring, so I guess it makes sense. But yeah, he's probably going to want to buy that one later anyway. I don't see a reason to skip the bottle on Tinker ever. Enigma's getting ganked up on top. They're looking for more lockdown. They only have the Earth Spike, and he actually doesn't get a range for the Hex, so Enigma's going to be fine. More peculiar rotations coming out from the supports of Zero Latitude as the Rubick down in bottom is going to drop to another Gemini attack coming out from Ming. And Ming, this is going to catch him up nicely in the bottom lane. Going to make up for his death pretty easily, and although he's not doing very well in levels, he is matching the Vipers, since this is pretty much a full tri-lane versus tri-lane scenario. Ming probably will go for boots in this lane, although, why not? It's still yet to be seen as Abaddon swinging his sword around a little bit with some animation canceling. Very peculiar. I've actually not seen that before, but either way, we have an illusion room picked up and deployed by the Death Prophet in mid, and the Death Prophet versus Tinker matchup is exactly in the middle, although Tinker with his ancient stack going is going to be slightly favored, especially once he picks that up. And Enigma's playing this offlane very well, in fact. He's able to harass very effectively with these Eidolons, and now they time out. He'll be able to get another set, and it's denying some experience from the Tidehunter. 13 and 14 on Godot. He's last hitting admirably. 9 and 2 on the Tidehunter is actually pretty good, especially considering how many denies the Enigma's gotten. They have turned these into dual lanes, which is okay, since the Lion wasn't really doing much on bottom anyway, but their killing potential is pretty much neutered everywhere. So is the trade that Zero Latitude is getting in farm going to favor them enough in order to warrant this? Their Death Prophet's doing well in mid, and that's really the silver lining for them. They have Phase Boots on to Accelerate, and that's not going to stop anytime soon. But this Tinker is almost completely not pressured. The spam coming up from Cryptstorm is annoying, especially with no bottle on your Tinker, but he's still sitting onto a salve, so he doesn't actually care. Even if he drops low, he'll be able to regenerate from that. Unfortunately, we're not seeing any more aggressive rotations, but as I say that, Zero Latitude throw their two supports over onto the enemy side and are looking to roam around on this Tinker. He does have backup in the form of the Abaddon, so it's not going to be the easiest kill of their lives, as an Aphotic Shield could really turn the tides of the war here. Lion, not spotted up by a Warden. I think they should know this, but Tinker is still playing defensively with both supports missing off of the map, and Rubick might have shown himself to these creeps. It is nighttime. After all, no pings coming out, so I don't think he's actually been shown. Tinker going to go down bottom, where that haste rune is spotted out by their Observer Ward. And he'll be able to secure this one for himself, so gank, unnotes to the Tinker, will be avoided by him just not being there. They'll pick up this haste rune, and now Abaddon just going to run down, accelerate. They don't have the backup, the Scarlet Mage is nowhere to be seen, and no points in the Curse of Avernus just yet. For the Abaddon, not going to lead them to anything. But still, wasted rotation going in from Lion and the Rubick, but what might not be wasted is this kill on the Enigma if they're able to get it. He has Black Hole, and it's pretty close to his tower. There might be a big turnaround. He has all of his Eidolons are doing a lot of damage to the Tidehunter, but they'll be able to clean them up, and now Godot is going to die before throwing out a single spell. There we go. Now that's the rotation that these supports could do, is the Viper drops in bottom lane, as Weaver is able to dive him very effectively, with the backup support coming out from the Abaddon, as well as the Skywrath Mage. I would say that that trait actually favors immunity there, is killing the Viper is arguably more important than killing the Enigma, because Enigma was going to get his farm one way or another. Whether he has to back up into the jungle or not is another story. Tinker with the Soul Ring, continuously farming up these Ancients, although he doesn't have another rearm. He'll be able to get his Boots of Travel at, well, if he clears that stack, he'll have them. That's incredibly fast farm for the Tinker, but he will need his bottle on top of it, which is why this is actually so crazy, but still farming admirably. I'd like to see him just buy the bottle and then do the stack, or sit in lane once and then buy the bottle, but let's see. Mid tower's coming apart. If they really want to be greedy, they could buy the bottle for the Tinker on one of the other lanes and allow the Tinker just to get huge, but I'm not sure who would actually do that. We are going to have a pause, which is unfortunate. Looks like Spicea and company are having a little bit more of issues with their PCs, but the early laning stage penny up for immunity with about a 1700 advantage in gold, and the experience also looking not too shabby at about 2500 in their favor. The laning phase and, I don't know, the ability of immunity to farm around the map just seems to be on another level coming out from Zero Latitude. The rotations from the supports are nice, and getting a kill and all is pretty good. It's just not enough. It's just not enough. Yeah, so we are going to be looking at how these heroes are currently working out. This Tinker, once he gets his Boots of Travel, is going to be very hard for Zero Latitude to actually catch out, especially once he gets the Blink Dagger on top of it. With it, the rate this Tinker is farming is going to be at a really solid timing. Yeah, they have no real way to catch him out. No great ways to get vision inside the trees, and they'll have to commit a Blink Ravage for it if they actually want to kill this Tinker, so it's going to be very difficult for them to actually catch him out. Tinker, when left unchecked, is going to be an absolute nightmare for Zero Latitude to push into. We are going to have a G's coming out from Zero Latitude, and hopefully from Immunity as well, as we're going to get into the rest of Game 2. And Viper is going to resume the game. Enigma, he's under a bit of pressure, and now the Accelerate is also in the lane. They want a 5-man down this tower with the point into Exorcism as well. She'll need the bottle charges before she gets the mana, but that's no problem. Yeah, bottling up, they'll pop the Exorcism for this, and they might be able to get it. They'll clean up the Eidolons as well, which is a decent amount of damage, but now with the March of Machines on the ground, as well as the Midnight Pulse, the defense coming out from Immunity is pretty strong, and Accelerate Just look at how much damage he took from the march. He can't stand there, and level 1 exorcism, not enough damage to get that tower. A bit greedy coming out from zero latitude there. It's going to give Skyrath Mage some room in mid while Tinker is farming up his ancients. Or going to be farming up his ancients, I should say. He is almost at those boots of travel. Just going to wait for his cooldown on March of the Machines before being able to clean this up. But once he has it, that'll be his bots. Almost for sure with... Yeah, for sure. For sure. Eidolon's up top are continuing to farm for the Enigma, although they will time out. Abaddon is going to also roam up there. It's going to put a lot of pressure on Zero Latitude to do something with this Ravage. They haven't used it yet, as Scythunder has just ticked level 6, but they need to start winning some of these fights. The mechanism isn't close for the Viper, as he's not farming particularly fast at 28 CS at almost 9 minutes in. And it really needs to be these two that are going to do something, because this Tinker is going to get out of hand very quickly. Even if you're going to avoid the bottle inside your laning phase, I think it's definitely worth it to get it later, as it just allows you to stay inside a base for the least amount of time. They throw a little bit of spells the way of the Viper, and now the March of Machines eating through Vans. About a third of his health going to be dropped from just those auto attacks as well as the March. Not going to be able to commit to that, as jumping into Ravage would definitely spell the Doom of Immunity, but the tower defense from the Tinker is going to be very strong. Usually when you see a Tinker pick, it's going to delay their ability to defend against those towers early on, but since he got the Boots of Travel at a good timing, that's not going to be the case. All of their tier 1 towers, despite taking a lot of harass, are not actually looking too unhealthy, all of them at above half damage. Weaver, in the meantime, we haven't talked about him for quite some time, is just farming up a storm at 45 and 7. After being left more or less unchecked, as now they jump in onto the lion, they have a Malifus to chase him down, and this is a pretty dead koala here. They drop the axe and they're TPing back in. Maybe they'll have to commit a black hole or something if they jump in. They get the exorcism, or rather the crypt swarm, onto Ming. He's caught under tower, and now the follow-up is going to be there with the lift. A little bit of an over-aggressive dive coming up from the Weaver, wasn't able to get any of his spells off. I thought he would have been able to at least get off a time-lapse there, but Immunity a little bit overzealous to get that kill on the lion. They probably should have just backed off there. Definitely not worth it at the end of the day, as we do have a Malphus going the way of the Viper, but Viper's going to return in kind with the Viper Strike on the Enigma. He commits the Black Hole to this, but the Eidolon's attacking. This could be a solo kill onto Spicy here. They do jump in with Rubick, and that's a stolen Black Hole onto the Rubick, and now they're going to lose their Enigma as well. A huge misplay coming out from Immunity, as after those last two kills, Zero Latitude have a huge teamfight advantage. They now have Black Hole as well as Ravage for probably only the next usage of Ravage, and they'll need a little bit more mana on the Rubick before they're able to do it, but ooh, that's really scary for them. And they'll be able to start 5-maning down those towers very easily. Though no level 11 Exorcism, still with maxed out Witchcraft, it does a decent amount of damage. Weaver shows his face. Not really a place where you can actually be, though. With just a Ring of Health and Aquila, Ming doesn't stand a chance. The Tinker March of Machines is going to be nice, and it will delay things. But that's really that all Immunity can do for the next minute or so, while Rubick maintains his possession of the Black Hole spell. They're doing it effectively, though, as Zero Latitude are not able to commit to this, and now with the Eidolons in mid, they're going to push into the tier 1 tower there. The Eidolons aren't doing that much damage, and with a couple of Crypt Storms, it will stop the push. They don't get any last hits, however, and it will only deter the push coming out in the bottom lane. Yep, smoke purchased up by the Rubick. With the Black Hole, he can definitely make a solo kill happen. And well, if he's able to catch up more than just one hero in the Black Hole, it could be huge. It's up on top. They might decide to make a go. It's very weird to see both of these teams just kind of, or rather Zero Latitude, not grouping up and pushing with all of the teamfight spells that they have at their disposal. I think they could just straight up 5-man down a tower. They kind of need the mechanism on the Viper before they can do that, and that's still a little bit ways away for Spicy here, as he's died once, and isn't getting the farm he needs. Also, Zero Latitude could probably back off into the Roshan pit with Gushiswell's Exorcism. I think they could take it, and it's just too dangerous to fight into that coming out from Immunity with the Black Hole as well as the Tidehunter Ravage online. It's, I don't know, just a little bit of a wasted opportunity if they let this Black Hole time out. They still have plenty of time available on it, about a third duration of the steal, but they need to make something happen. They're not in position to use it. It's down at bottom. They might look for something. The Tidehunter's leading the charge, so to say, but without any positioning tools on the Rubick or the Tide, it's going to be hard for them to actually catch somebody out. But if they get a lift on the Ming, they'll definitely be able to combo him down. Viper's mechanism is almost there, but it's going to miss the timing window of having Black Hole, and as good as it is to have Black Hole, if you can't use it, it's a pretty useless spell, as all spells are. Tinker is just having the time of his life in the farming department. Is the Weaver's going to die in bottom as I miss it? Oh my goodness, just blasted to death by the finger. Too fast to cast there. They didn't need to use either of the big ultimates in the Black Hole or the Ravage, so still going to have that for a little bit longer, but it's not going to last much before they actually have to blow it. If you find a single target now, I think you just Black Hole the heck out of them. Yep. I think that's more or less what they need to do. But I think Black Hole's going to time out before we actually get to see it cast by the Rubick. A good spell, going to be more useful as a deterrent than anything else. Yeah, Scarth Mage, currently the lowest net worth, but he has pretty much all that he needs. In the Arcane Boots, he'll be able to spam out his spells pretty effectively and has a good enough mana pool to use all of his spells. And while the G's are going to come out after the second pause of this game, with remakes as well as two pauses, that makes it increasingly difficult to solo cast it. Yeah, we are going to have 150 second cooldown on that Finger of Death, or 160, excuse me, before he's able to zap down the Weaver. But with his current items, Weaver is just not tanky enough to really survive up against any sort of burst damage. Rubick, we're just going to watch that Black Hole timeout in the saddest moment of Rubick's life. Honestly, if that were a pub game, I'm sure he would just cast it for kicks and giggles just to say that he cast Black Hole. But now, Tinker, as well as the company behind him, are going to go back as Weaver time-lapses into the lane, a mechanism that a lot of people aren't aware about, but actually when you're dead, your hero is technically where they died. So time-lapse, even if you don't instantly buy back, you can still time-lapse to where you were, as Qualia is going to get stunned onto Ming, but eat a decent amount of damage from the Aphotic Shield. Weaver can't dive that, and yeah, it's just too risky for him to do so. Black Hole is available for the Enigma yet again. They might go into mid. The Concussive Shot is going to land in Death Prop, but with 4 points into Witchcraft as well as the Phase Boots, she's too fast to actually be caught out. Immunity are looking good if they're able to maintain this turtling coming out that they have from all of their team members. They have a Tinker with a Blink Dagger at 14 minutes in, which is a wonderful timing for that Blink, and also on the top of the net worth chart. Weaver, although not picking up that much farm, eventually is going to be quite a potent threat in this game, and Immunity need to hit that timing. For now, it is Zero Latitude that have the advantage in the team fights. But they're still waiting on this level 11 Exorcism coming out from the Death Prophet, although she's very close. Yule's Scepter is completed by Accelerate as well. Another way to cancel the Black Hole coming up from Immunity. And, well, compared to the last couple of games, this is a lot more passive than it has been. I guess it's going to be not disjointed by the Tinker, potentially. I don't know, the particles were there, but no debuff onto the Tinker. The March of Machines is going to be deployed. It's not going to do much damage to the creeps, but it will tag the Tidehunter. Another March deployed, and that one will clean up the creep wave. Whether it gets last hits or not is another story. He'll at least get two of them and secure that this lane is pushing in their favor. Bottom lane might be the next place where we have a fight as the Enigma is inbound. They're going to hex up the Weaver, and you might have to commit the Black Hole to this. The Malphus is going to go with Spisa as they jump in. The lasers, it's not going to be enough damage as the mechanism comes out for the Viper. He's going to stop walking for a little bit. The bug is on him, but he'll be just fine. The March of Machines on the ground, and a lot of aggressive posturing going to end in very little actual kills going on in that bottom lane. Scarath Mage is just farming away and kind of functioning like a mid-Scarath Mage, except for at this point in the game, mid-Scarath is probably going to be roaming around and ganking as best he can in mid. They're going to throw the Concussive Shot to the Death Prophet, and yet again, that's going to be a similar story to just minutes ago, as Death Prophet's going to be able to walk that one off. Death Prophet is actually going to make a turn on the Scarath, and with a well-timed silence as well as Cryptstorm, this could be a fairly easy kill, so Finger of Death goes away of the Enigma before they get the Black Hole. Uphill miss onto Intel, they're not going to get that kill, and now Cryptstorm, they thought he was hiding in the trees, it's not going to be the case, as now they're grouped up. They have their teamfight ultimates, and I think they can do this, but the creep wave might die too quickly. The March of Machines, as Tinker is fast on the reactions, is going to be able to clean that one up. It's your Latitude getting a good pick off onto the Enigma, but that's going to be another 160 seconds without a Lion Finger of Death, and really another 160 seconds before they want to force the issue. They need a pipe on this team pretty badly. Tidehunter is dirt poor. I don't see him getting it anytime soon. Viper would be the ideal candidate, and it looks like he is going to be the one to purchase that one up, although his mana is going to be pretty problematic. Unless they have mana boots popped for him, he won't be able to get off his whole full barrage of spells as well as the mech and pipe. But yeah, without the pipe, they're going to have a really difficult time pushing into these towers. One of the big reasons why Tinker is so strong is because of March of Machines. March of Machines is a ridiculous spell. And he has the bottle online and now working well on his way towards the Dagon. This is one of the scariest Tinkers to go up against as far as item progression is concerned. He's at 160s. At this point in the game, and also KDA is looking pretty solid. at not dying. He hasn't been involved or gotten a single kill. But really, for your Tinker, at this point in the game, he's not there to get those kills. You want to wait until he gets a Dagon before he's actually able to do that. You just want him to not die. Shikuchi stolen by the Rubik, one of the better spells for him to steal. Going to be a very aggressive behind the tower with it. And might be able to find initiation here. I'm still waiting for Zero Latitude to put their team fight together. They haven't used Ravage in a big engagement yet, and it's 17 and a half minutes in. Immunity are fine with this low-paced game, which is why we're not seeing a clash for them. It's in Zero Latitude's court in order to force the issue. Abaddon is best buddies with Weaver, and we'll just sit behind him until Weaver gets enough farm, and even then, it's probably the best time to jump on him. A big wraparound on the Tinker. Will they be able to get in range for anything? Shikuchi not used by the Rubik and won't be able to get in range for the lift. And with backup from the Abaddon, it's not going to happen. Wasted rotation yet again from these supports, which is kind of the story of this game. They've gotten some kills and they've been involved in some good kills. Five apiece. They've not parted ways since the beginning of this game. Looks like Dire's bottom tower got this home. But yeah, it's just a very awkward trade. It's the towers are falling, and now in the favor of Immunity, they lose their 2-1 tower to the Enigma, and the bottom one is denied. So a little bit of economic damage, but it's really not going to hurt them that much. Their team can rely on their late game as they're chain stunning down Ming. Ming will be able to focus down. He's not able to get the time loss off. They commit the Ravage. They'll be able to get that kill, although at a cost of the Ravage cooldown. Despite leading in kills, Zero Latitude, they have very little ability to fight now. And now top lane, they're going to jump in the black hole. It's going to not do much of anything except for killed off the Death Prophet, which will be secured by the Sky with Mage. Now the Lion going to die the Marching Machines, if nothing else. Tinker gets the last hit there. Now the Tier 2 tower up top is not going to look very healthy, as the Eidolon's auto-attacking onto that one, as well as the second set coming up soon. They might actually be able to take this. Tier 1 tower down and bottom is going to die for it. It's Tinker TP's back in. He's not going to blink out immediately. Didn't shift Q that. Now he's going to need a Viper Strike. A big misplay coming up from Chains. He can't blink now. He's going to try to turn this the best of his ability. Vance might die here with the enemy dropping the Malphus inside the March of Machines. But Tinker dying there is actually huge. He has buyback if he needs it. But yeah. I think that's a pretty big misplay, actually. Spice, I know what, he cancel that TP and he'll be just fine. Enigma, 2,500 gold. I think that this is going to be just a straight up BKB for him, because without, or with BKB, rather, they have no way to cancel his back hole. But then again, it might be a blink. He hasn't been sitting on that 2150 gold for that much long, or for that long. But maybe he's just going to hold off onto it until he sees a little bit more of the items coming out from Zero Latitude. Tinker, his item of choice is actually going to be the Bloodstone. They're just going to play this very passively. Bloodstone on Tinker is really solid for keeping him outside of the base for as long as possible, and by the nature of the hero, he's going to be involved in kills and get those charges, and should not die. Also, the reduced Bloodstone timer for the respawn is very important for Tinker and might save him a buyback or two down the line. I'm okay with this choice, although the more aggressive one would be a lot more fun to watch for me. Slow and steady wins the race, it seems. Immunity are going to take that option, as it is a blink dagger for the Enigma. Finally chooses to spend his gold. It's Rubik up top, ooh, with Ace Rune on the Enigma, as well as the blink dagger being delivered. He doesn't have the blink just yet, but I think Rubik might be dead. But if nothing else, it is going to be a tier 2 tower going their way, one way or another. Whether it's denied by the Rubik or otherwise is another story. It looks like he'll look for it, but with the Enigma there, he needs to be careful. There's a Haste Rune there, and he won't get the last of his. Enigma does with the Eidolons. Eidolon stolen by Levita. That's a good spell to steal. Actually, most of the spells coming out from Enigma are good. I don't think there's actually a bad one. Midnight Pulse is pretty strong, especially if you max it out. We do have that Hood of Defiance coming out from the Viper. He's going to be very tanky, but until he gets that pipe, Zero Latitude are losing their grip on this game, if they ever had one. The gold advantage is at 7,500 in their favor of Immunity, and Experience also looking pretty good at 5,000. I would say that Zero Latitude's lineup had to be an advantage at this point in the game, and they're not. They don't have a Viper that's going to be much of a right-click damage dealer at all, as well. Ming might be in a little bit of trouble. Can't get the kill on the Viper. Almost blinded the stun onto him, but we'll do a lot of harass to him. And if he sticks around a little bit longer, maybe they'll be able to get that kill. I don't know. Enigma Eidolon's pushing out mid. Top is being handled by the Tinker as well. He might need to drop another march here sooner rather than later, as the Death Prophet is spamming that out. He will come in. I don't think they can kill this creep wave off, and oh, with the slow going, he's gonna try to TP out. The silence comes out, not enough damage. Will they be able to get? No, Tinker didn't go for the rocket, so this were maxed out and potentially could have gotten the kill, although unlikely. Jump in from the Enigma, gets a double black hole. Where's the follow-up damage? It is coming out from the Weaver. It's not that fast, but they'll be able to get Koala and now Viper. The next one to be focused down. The Rocket's not doing that much, but the Laser is going to do pure damage in Tinker. He's lifted up in the air, Gush back, drop back, and now the Ravage onto four heroes. But where's the follow-up damage? Here comes another Concussive Shot from the Skywrath Mage. The Death Prophet is in there with the X's, and that's the damage that they needed during the Tidehunter Ravage, but is it going to be enough? Shaitan is really the only one there, and he has his ultimate available. He's going to pop it and going to eat a lot of damage from those X's and Ghosts, but that's just going to heal him up as they jump back in with the jump in from the Tinker. The double lasers as well as the missiles are going to be enough. The Yule Scepter, the Death Prophet, that's only going to delay the inevitable as Jodin is going to eat himself a, or Goda rather, he's going to eat himself a finger of death, but in the end they secure every single kill on the enemy side, with the exception, or with the only death on theirs being the Abaddon. Excuse me, it is getting rather late or early, depending on how you're looking at it for me, so hopefully I'll be joined by a co-caster, or be the co-caster for the Titan versus Zero Latitude game. It has been quite a long day. So going to the tier 2 tower and bottom, and it looks like Immunity are going to be able to take a really convincing win. This Tinker, he joined at the very end. He now has 12 Bloodstone charges involved in 4 of those kills, and he's going to have his Dagon on top very fast. 1250 gold already, and now he's going to jump back behind the tower. The Viper not taking that much damage, and now with the Weaver auto-attacking him, as well as the Malphite going his way. I don't think he's making out of this. This honestly would have been very useful earlier on, but that will secure Weaver the last hit on that kill. Enigma now has almost enough gold for his BKB on top of his Blink. Absolutely ridiculous farm on him. Lincoln's Fear on the Weaver, although it's going to keep him alive, isn't going to have him doing damage, but he doesn't need to, as Immunity have plenty of other tools in order to get the deeps out, most notably the Tinker here, who's having an absolute field day. 4-1-4 on your Tinker. This is pretty much exactly what you want from your Tinker, especially after dying once in the lightning phase. Rubik going to say hello to the Enigma, although with the double damage rune, he might be able to do a little bit more. He needs to be careful. The Weaver is rotating in as well. He could turn for Malphite once he shows himself, but he'll lift up Godot, trying to get this kill. The Malphite comes out, and now Mechanism is available for Godot as well as the Tick Charges. He has 5 of them, and I think Levita is going to die. Do they have detection on the ground? No, they don't. They have a sentry. They jump in with the Tidehunter. He's going to be able to blow up. Nobody is. The Blink away from the Enigma is going to keep him safe. Another boost of travel. He's going to be canceled, as the Eidolon was killed by the Tidehunter. Tinker does have his Dagon available, and well, now Tidehunter going to be chased down. Although the Weaver is doing very little damage, Tinker comes in from the sidelines with a laser rocket from the creep wave, and now Lion needs to get the hell out of Dodge, as he is in a very precarious corner. Nobody cancel out TP coming out from the Tinker, and well, there he goes. Tinker goes back to base. And it's back to passive gaming for Immunity. They can keep on getting these pickoffs and are looking really solid throughout this game. Zero Latitude, they had a couple of timings where I thought they could push, but they're respecting this Tinker maybe a little bit too much. Yeah. It's not looking very good at all. Death Prophet is up in top. She's going to start spamming out the creep wave with the Crypt Storm in the Lion. She has an Atos, and she's really the only hero that's even close to what you want to have at this point in the game. Pipe is getting close for the Viper, but the Pipe isn't going to help him right-click. It's going to help them sit the Death Prophet on the high ground, which is nice. But with the Dagon now and the Tinker, he'll be able to burst her down. Even through the pipe, like with March of Machines, that's probably going to get most of it, and then they can just rearm. And once this Weaver gets his next item, whether that be a Desolator, which is what I'm hoping out for, or an MKB, which would be another solid straight up damage item for him, he's going to be hitting hard. He has enough money for one of the Mithril Hammers, which honestly I'd like to see him pick up. Speaking of Mithril Hammers, we are going to have a BKB picked up by the Enigma, as he's going to build his into that magic community. He's up in top. We jump in from the Tinker. He has the Dagon, Finger of Death going the way of Chains, but it's not going to do damage with the Bloodstone. He's decently tanky. They drop the Exorcism for this, as well as the Atos. He's going to deny himself a very quick deny, actually. I think Tinker could have wasted a little bit more time, but with 12 Bloodstone charges, he doesn't actually care. He's going to respawn very quickly and still have 9 available. After the rearm, he's going to have his Bloodstone Suicide available, and I don't see this Tinker actually legitimately dying anytime soon. Unfortunately, the laser cast animation was a little too long there. He almost killed the Death Prophet. In mid, we have a Concussive Shot Silence the way of Levita, and Levita, now with Skywrath Mage Ultimate being dropped, it's still on cooldown, unfortunately. Or, fortunately, if you're Levita, the Arcane Bolts are going to continue flying as Tinker joins the fray as well. The Rockets are going to land as well. Lincoln's Fear going to be put to good use as being. He's going to be silenced up, can't get off his time-lapse, and he needs to back up for now. There's a beautiful Ravage going to land on almost everybody, with the exception of the Enigma, who hasn't joined the fight. He has a black hole. Where is it? Where's the black hole? Give me 4, man! No! He's got to commit just to the Vipers. Everybody else is dead, and the Death Prophet is up in the air. Unfortunate. I saw the beautiful timing, but it wasn't there. Up the high ground coming out from the line, and they're just gonna dive this to all ends of the earth, or not. They're gonna back off and take the tier 2 tower, be a little bit more conservative here, as they still win a convincing fight despite not having the best black hole. Dagon is being leveled up by the Tinker. I don't want to see him level it all the way up to 5. I'd like to see level 3, then Ethereal Blade, I think is probably the better build as far as efficiency and damage is concerned. Well, that's your last tier 2 tower standing, taken down by immunity, and I really don't want to take a look at these graphs. At this point in the game, it's going to look scary, and swoop, straight up going in the favor of immunity and the experience looking pretty similar. Although, it did dip down after losing their Tinker and whatnot. Now it's in the Roshan pit for them. It's not the fastest Roshan by any means. They don't have the best sustain. They have an urn as well as a mechanism, and that's about it. But with the Curse of Avernus level 1, it's going to help this go by a little bit faster. No Ravage for 78 seconds and no spell on the Rubick. I don't think they have a hope of contesting this one. If Rubick pokes his head in, he's going to die. And Rubick, Levita, this is not a great place. They're going toward the high ground and not go firm, as that would give away their positioning in Roshan. But they'll secure themselves a Roshan. And, well, they'll give that Aegis probably to the Weaver. There you go, Weaver going to find himself an Aegis, and now in bottom, Koala as well as the Vita are in a bit of trouble here, as the Viper's gone in by the Tinker. He's going to mech up, and, well, he survives decently from the barrage, but he will be forced back as, oh, they're looking for more. They find the Tide Hunter, and they might find the Rubick. Concussive Shot slows down Vans, and now he's going to Malifist up as well. There's a Silence Wave of Levita. He's going to take a lot of damage from this Weaver. Even without the Desolator completed, it's still going to be enough to get him with the Arcane Bolt flying through, and now the Tinker cleaning up on the back lines as that fight's breaking out. TP attempt coming out from the Death Prophet, almost not going to finish this. We have a BKB forced out by the Enigma. Now the Dagon level 3 and the Tinker, and they might be diving the base for this one. I don't know, that's 3 for 0, as now they're jumping in. Concussive Shot onto Spice. The Spice is pretty much dead here. They drop the Exorcism behind the tower, which is what they want, and after baiting that out, they might be able to get out of here, or Risk is going to die. He is going to fall, but the Death Prophet might also die. That's the Aegis down, and now the Tinker laser onto the Viper. Full 5-man wipe in the trade for the Skywrath Mage, as well as the Aegis on the Weaver. Definitely worth it for immunity. Despite being an apparently aggressive dive with the amount of farm that they had on top of zero Latitude, it didn't matter. There was nothing they could do. Viper survives, but not against the pure damage coming out from the Tinker, and he doesn't have any raw HP in order to survive as well. Tier 3 tower is not going to die just yet. Oh, the Lion. Obliterated. I think he's a one combo hero, as is the Rubick. With a Dagon level, what is that, 4 now? Yeah, he's going to die in one barrage of Tinker spells. Tinker doesn't have the most mana, but he has 16 Bloodstone charges, so that's going to change very shortly. He's just sitting on the sidelines as the Weaver takes down the barracks and blinks forward. Who's he going to find, if anybody? Oh no, Levita. Levita, don't show your face. Okay, Levita, he didn't show his face. Bugs? Did they get vision? No, they didn't. Chains is still waiting in the wings. And here he comes. Spice going to be zapped by the Dagon as well as the laser. They're going to commit the Ravage over to Chains. And it looks like Chains is going to die. Will be able to gain kills before he goes. He will just suicide himself very early as Refresh is stolen by the Rubick. There's a BKB forced out by anything, but he's trying to run away here. Will he be able to make it out with the Blink Dagger? You sure bet he will. And Ming is going to be going for an Eye of Scotty. Pretty much, why the heck not item at this point? As they can't kill him. And now the Tinker coming in, they need to get out of here. Tinker, his creep is going to be killed. No, he's actually going to be able to make it in there as he backed off. Now the Dagon, he's going to kill Vans, or is he? Jumps in a little far, he doesn't have backup there. And now Koala, if there's one Dagon, that's going to kill this poor Lion here. And, well, rockets forward, Malphus onto the Lion. Lion, where is the Weaver? Where is the Tinker? They're going to pop the Abaddon Shield and now go on to Spice. The Spice, they're going to steal something from the Weaver. It's going to be Shikuchi. It's not going to matter at all. They lift up Ming, but that's it. Tier 3 tower, as well as the barracks, is going to fall, I think. They don't have the best pushing lineup, but it's going to be enough. Slowly but surely, immunity. Take the first lane of Rax, and I don't see this game going any differently. When you're behind against a Tinker, you're always scared about him turtling it out. And when you're ahead as a Tinker, there's very little risk of throwing the game, unless you consistently die to the enemy team. And although his kill score is 10, 3, and 8, two of those deaths were suicides that he came back from very quickly with his Bloodstone charges. So honestly, Chains doesn't care about those. It would be nice to have 16 Bloodstone charges, don't get me wrong. But it's also fine to not die. And now he's going to put pressure on all of the lanes, and I think Zero Latitude, sooner rather than later, are just going to be choked out. 30 minutes in, the gold graph is looking scary at above 25,000 gold experience lead, and it's not getting any different. It's down in bottom, we're looking at probably the last engagement. The Lion's trying to drain as much mana as possible as they jump in. Black Hole onto 4. Scarlet Mage ulti only clipping onto one of them. Where's the Tinker in all this? Just zap him to death. They're going to get the pipe off, and that's going to delay things for now. The Tinker finally comes in with the rockets. He's going to blow up the Death Prophet. Now they're chasing down the Tidehunter. Tidehunter's going to die. Chains going to be able to refresh one more, and then he's going to be able to zap one more. And now Viper chasing down. He's pretty tanky up against this magic damage, but not tanky enough. Dagon 5 and GG called up by Levita as they can take a completely dominating fight with a 4-man black hole. He was waiting for it all game, and he got it, friends. So, as for now, that is going to round out the action here on HeflaTV 2. as we are going to have some more later on, but for now I'm going to direct you over to HeflaTV 1, where we still have some MPGL games going on, as those are best of threes and not best of twos. So thank you for watching. If you like the casting you see here, you can follow us on HeflaTV on Twitter and Facebook, as well as on HeflaTV 1 and 2 on Twitch, which are our English channels. VODs will be uploaded to youtube.com/heflamoke, and that rounds out all of the places where you can find us. I'm Grandis V, and I've been your caster throughout the entirety of this day. Hopefully later on I'll be able to get a co-caster or be the co-caster for somebody else. But for now, a round of ads as well as some music before I relocate you over to HeflaTV 1. So thanks for watching. Hope to see you soon.